Obama making a surprise late-night trip to Dover Air Force Base. He traveled there to personally pay his respects to some of the victims of the growing violence in Afghanistan. He saluted as the bodies of 18 Americans killed just this week arrived back home, this shortly before 4 o'clock in the morning Eastern. The president also took time to meet with their family members. In all, 60 Americans who have died in Afghanistan this month alone, the deadliest of the entire war. The president still considering his options on troop levels. The AP reports he's moving to some version of a middle ground. The idea is to send more forces, but not as many as the 40,000 General McChrystal has requested. NBC News chief foreign correspondent Richard Engel in Kabul for us. Richard, what is the tone, and particularly the tone of this month in the context of the time that you've spent in Afghanistan in recent months and, for that matter, recent years?
There is a real concern that security overall is deteriorating quite quickly and deteriorating here in Kabul itself. Many people were quite disturbed by the attack yesterday at that guest house used by the United Nations. It struck in an area where many people had felt previously secure, that the war had been out in the provinces. It had been in this Pashtun beltway. It hadn't been right in the city center. So there is a feeling that the situation has changed here and is getting worse.
Is there a clamor there one way or the other relative to the U.S. that is clear?
There is not a clear consensus of what should be done here. There is an overall feeling that just there is a bureaucratic drift as the political process continues. There is very little enthusiasm for the elections that are supposed to take place on November 7th. In fact, there are many concerns that these new elections, the second round, will be just as plagued with corruption and low voter turnout as the last round. And there are many people worried that it will not produce a conclusive result.
Richard, if the underlying stability of that country is a function of our ability to win the hearts and minds of those who are there, either by adding troops and creating security or by removing troops and reducing violence, if that's, I don't know what the right answer is, but if we can't do anything versus Al-Qaeda with a civilian population that lives in terror, what is your sense of the time that you've been there when the civilian population has been the most comfortable living normal lives, going to school, having dinner with their families?
Sure. It has really changed over the last 6 months or so. A year or two ago, people were quite open and comfortable. There was a lot more traffic on the streets. People were moving around. Inside Kabul, there's still quite a bit of freedom of movement, but moving within the country, going between Kandahar and Kabul, for example. Now many Afghans are too afraid to drive those highways, and they are afraid to reach out to American troops. You talked about the American soldiers' ability to try and win hearts and minds and give out humanitarian assistance, but many Afghans are afraid to take it because they think the Taliban will then come to their houses at night and punish them or kill them for having done that.
Understood. Richard, thank you so much. Again, at issue here for all of us in this debate, obviously the lives of our children first and foremost. Secondarily, the incredible burden both economically and politically on this country from its involvement in all of these wars. The question, does adding more troops create the stability that we seek so that we can fight Al-Qaeda, or does adding more troops in fact exacerbate the violence in that country and blow up in our face? That's the underlying debate. In other words, is there a more efficient way to do it? Dan Senior, senior fellow at the senior fellow for Middle Eastern Studies on the Council of Foreign Relations, author of Startup Nation, The Story of Israel's Economic Miracle, former Bush advisor on foreign policy, and smarty pants for sure when it comes to the Middle East. Dan, it is nice to see
smarty
you.
Pants.
So you qualify for sure. So Glenn Greenwald, similarly smarty pants, but also author, The Great American Hypocrites, topping the big miss of Republican politics. Glenn, it is a pleasure to have you back with us. Dan, the fundamental question, does adding more troops achieve American objectives in stability and protecting ourselves from Al-Qaeda, et cetera, or does it exacerbate the creation of more terrorists and the creation of more violence?
Well,
how do you even evaluate
that?
Yeah,
no, what the commanders will argue in Afghanistan, General Petraeus at CENTCOM and General McChrystal in Afghanistan, and the senior staff of the joint staff will all argue that unless you have buy-in from the civilian population,
which Engel said has deteriorated over the past year.
Deteriorated. Of course it's deteriorated, because we're unreliable, because we can't provide them basic security. So why should they stick their heads out and take the risk in helping us if they know that the Taliban and al-Qaeda are more reliable than we are, and that they will not only wipe out that Afghani that steps up and risks his life to help us, but they'll wipe out his family's entire neighborhood and perhaps the entire village. Unless you get civilian population buy-in, you don't get security, you don't get key intelligence, you don't get improvements in governance, you don't get anything. So that is a starting point. We have not had basic security in the civilian areas in Afghanistan, really at all for a while.
Glenn, as you look at this both ways, and I'll add to it the fact that, again, Afghanistan is a country that is it's a country of drug lords, where basically it's a drug lord driven country whose primary asset is a heroin crop and a bunch of rocks. At the same time, they have been in the past a very fertile place for people to breed and execute anti-American sentiment, not the least of which 9/11. As you look at this going into 2010, how do you put the debate in perspective?
Well, I just find it amazing that we actually still think that one way to address terrorism, the root of which is anti-American sentiment, the willingness of people to strap on bombs to their waist and blow themselves up to inflict damage on us, that the way to address that is for us to send our military and occupy foreign countries that don't want us there. And the idea that Afghans want the United States military to continue to occupy their country while we're occupying Iraq, continuing to drop bombs on Pakistan, fueling and funding Israel to drop bombs on multiple Muslim countries, I think is lunacy. The more we continue to interfere in the Muslim world, the more anti-American sentiment there will be, the more desire there will be to attack Americans.
Can we get the map of the Middle East back up, you guys, on the table? Dan, your response to that?
This was the exact same argument made by many people in Iraq. The argument was that we were an antibody in Iraqi society.
Why is that wrong?
The problem was Iraqi political leaders came to us, to the Americans, and said, we want to help you, we're willing to work with you, but the insurgency in Iraq is more reliable than you are. We can't cooperate with you if you don't provide us basic security. And it was only once we provided basic security in 2007 with the surge that we really got some cooperation, stabilization in Iraq. If you think that us pulling out and have no troops on the ground, which is basically sounds like what you're arguing, and zero security, that is going to create a more stable situation, it's completely inconsistent with how every counterinsurgency, counterinsurgency.
But is our obligation, Dan, to have a stable situation in Afghanistan? Go ahead, Glenn.
Well, I mean, again, the fantasies that have been fueling our Middle East policy since 2001 from the Bush administration continue to fuel it today, and you just heard it, which is the idea that Iraqis are crying out for Americans to invade their country and protect them and give them security. Iraqis came to America
He's saying after we were there,
after we invaded, Iraqis were attacking American troops and trying to blow them up and were putting IEDs on the road and trying to kill them because Iraqis didn't want foreign armies to be occupying their country. Of course, the government that we set up, the Maliki government that we set up and that are our allies, wants us to stay there. Of course they do. We're protecting them. We're enabling their power.
Now that we're bribing
the people that we spent 5 years calling terrorists, the Sunni rejectionists, which is what the Bush administration called, now that we're bribing them, they too want us to continue to be paying them.
But
that makes sense.
I have to wrap it up, but I'm interested in your answer, Glenn, to his question, which is, we can say, listen, maybe the war as it has been executed in Afghanistan the past 7 years is an unadulterated fiasco. I'm not debating the past. We're sitting here looking at more of our children, more of our money, more of our potential risk. And while you may be right, get the heck out. It's crazy. Dan's point is doing that, unfortunately, it's sort of the Colin Powell quote from before we went in the first place, which the Pottery Barn reference, which is you break it, you bought it. And it's hard for people to get around
that is a recipe for endless war, for perpetual occupation. We do not have the ability, even if we should be doing it, to go manage the rest of the world. We can barely manage our own country. I think if we pull out, the vast majority of people who are currently fighting us in Afghanistan will lose the cause to continue to engage in violence. The Afghans will be able to get together and work out their own government. We can assist them. We can aid them. We can provide humanitarian assistance and other forms of economic rights.
Why is that so crazy?
But the idea that we're going to occupy this country forever is
crazy.
there were thousands of people in al-Qaeda training camps in Afghanistan before September 11th. We weren't occupying the country. Let me finish. In fact, in the 90s, we had gone, the Clinton administration had gone to great efforts to get an Israeli-Palestinian peace process done. In the Balkans, the Americans had put their lives on the line to protect Bosnian Muslims.
United States involvement in the Middle East didn't begin in 2001. We've been funding and fueling Israel. It's attacked multiple Muslim countries. We overthrew the democratically elected Iranian government and supported the Shah of Iran. We've had bases in Saudi Arabia. We are interfering in their world, and naturally, many of them now want to interfere in
ours. We have to wrap it up.